Look who it is. I grow impatient.
Hey, Illidan. Sorry things took so long. I was trying to make a skit, but good quality footage of Vosh and Kale just don't exist.
I feel I should be offended, but I'm not certain why.
Yeah, and if you think that's bad, Vosh is even worse.
Illidan will show us the path to power.
Now, for the love of...
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, this is Giant Grant Games, and today we're back with another Deathless Run. The rules haven't changed, and neither has my appreciation for my patrons, so let's jump right into this. We start off with Misconceptions. The objective is to fully repair three observatories around the map. The mission starts off with a no-build segment, and then transitions into a normal production game about one-third of the way in. The Blood Elf faction is a weird mishmash of reskinned human and Night Elf units. The Swordsman is just the Footman, and the Archer is the Night Elf Archer. These two serve as the baseline combat units for the faction, which is really annoying because Footman and Archer are two of the worst units in a Deathless Run. Both are severely lacking in the durability department. In fact, every Blood Elf unit is incredibly low on HP and armor. It's really, really frustrating. Similarly to the human campaign, I do get the Priest. Their heal ability does a solid job of dealing with low to mid amounts of damage, but lacks powerful heals against single targets. All in all, the faction is without a doubt the least durable in Warcraft 3, and that sucks. My hero unit is Kael'thas. He has a large area of effect fire attack and the ability to banish enemies or allies. Banish is a great tool for Deathless Runs. It can temporarily disable strong enemies or phase out my allies that are taking too much heat. After clearing the no-build segment and activating the first observatory, I get a base on an island. Unfortunately, the island also houses an undead base who sends attacks early and often. Repairing the observatories is fairly expensive, and it takes a while, but multiple peasants can work on them at the same time. I opt to build my economy to a crazy level while skimping on army. The undead attack waves get pretty scary over time, but I do not plan on staying long. I also construct the Arcane Vault, a building that allows me to purchase items, and then I start buying the Ivory Tower. They stack up to 5 per item slot, so I opt to fill 4 of Kael's slots with them, for a total of 20 towers. Once I have my towers and enough money to repair the remaining observatories, I fully evacuate my base. The first observatory is nearby and is fixed quickly. The second, on the other hand, is guarded by a ton of gnolls, including the powerful Snarlmane the Bloodgorger. He's level 11, literally a higher level than Archimonde or Cenarius. I have no idea how a gnoll of all things got this strong. I don't want to fight him. This is where Kael's banish ability shines. I can temporarily remove Snarlmane from existence while my peons finish the observatory. And they do just that. And then the mission doesn't end. It doesn't say so, but I guess I have to kill Snarlmane. Fortunately, by now, the gnoll has no remaining mana. I pull back wounded forces, and he goes down cleanly. And the mission still doesn't end. So I wait. There are no other main objectives on the mission. Trust me, I had time to double check. I didn't want to be eliminated by the undead, so I started constructing a lumber mill. Oh, we're done now? Okay, Reforged. You do you. After the fiasco that was the Sentinel's Deathless Run, I started putting a lot more time into learning the exact mechanics of each Warcraft 3 mission before attempting them deathless. A Dark Covenant is a fantastic example of an absurd mission where strategic forethought is required. It's not a mission where deathless victory comes by accident. The mission is split into two phases. I start with 5 bases around the map, 4 who are mining on the edges, and a base without a gold mine in the center. The mission starts with the undead sending a massive onslaught against the 4 bases around the outside. I use Kael and Scrolls of Town Portal to rescue everybody up north, and then send him to the south. Once the 4 perimeter bases are defeated, phase 2 starts. In order to prevent the mission from being cheesed, Blizzard added an extra trigger. If one of the attack waves is defeated, the mission progresses to part 2 as if you had lost anyway. It's a clever, but very obnoxious way to stop players from holding onto a base. After part 1, 2 things happen. The Naga Lady Vosh comes and brings reinforcements, and the main undead base is activated. I'm supposed to reclaim the bases, build up an army, and then defeat the green undead. However, the attack waves that green sends are absolutely insane. They have huge army sizes, great upgrades, and a level 7 dreadlord that can push out serious area damage with Carrion Swarm and Infernal. Fortunately for me, when Blizzard was adding their anti-cheese mechanics to the map, they were not preparing for advanced cheese. I used most of the ivory towers that I purchased in the last mission to fortify the southeastern base. I need to be able to hold off against the undead attack. The towers take a beating, but they manage to survive. Once the bulk of the attack wave was finished off, only a few meat wagons who have longer range than the defending towers remain. It's a common theme in RTS for units with long range to have a minimum range as well that they can't fire in. This is what my strategy hinges on. I use the remaining rapid build ivory towers to surround the final meat wagon. After it finishes off any guard towers in range, it is now walled in by towers that it's too close to hit. It's stuck. As long as this wagon survives, the game considers the phase 1 attacks ongoing and doesn't transition. This means that the terrifying green attacks never come. Green is not a pushover though, and I don't have a diverse selection of units to work with. I opt to make a massive army of Dragonhawk Riders. This allows me to utilize the nearby terrain to my advantage. They have two spells, Aerial Shackles, which is a phenomenal ability for disabling the frost worms that defend the base, and Cloud, which disables the static defense structures nearby as well. The low damage of the Dragonhawk Riders make progress slow. To the south of the fight, I set up a small medical station with priests. Now I can cycle riders in and out so everybody stays patched up, and after a few minutes of fighting in the base, it's cracked and cleanup is easy. I didn't even need to meet Lady Vosh. The Dungeons of Dalaran is the first no-build mission in the campaign, and oh joy, it's been reforged. The original mission was a dungeon crawler. There were a huge number of hidden items around the map, and it was worth going over a second time to make sure everything was found. Some of the locations, particularly for the bonus quest, could be pretty tricky to find. This version is the same in theory, but the puzzles have been made painfully obvious, and the path feels much more linear. Additionally, the mission is just flat out easier. I finally get access to the second hero of the campaign, the Naga Lady Vosh. The entire reason that Kael and his forces were thrown into prison is that he was working with these Naga in the last mission, even though this is the first time they've ever met. Vosh is primarily a spellcaster, just like Kael, however she holds one huge advantage over him. Flamestrike is a total liability in this run due to hurting my own forces. Vosh's Forked Lightning, on the other hand, is pure upside. It might have less potential damage, but the pinpoint precision more than makes up for it. The main gimmick involves colored runes. If Kael and Vosh stand on runes of the same color, an item will unlock or a door will open. Some of these rune locations used to be a bit tricky to find, but they made sure to idiot-proof it this time. There is no sense of exploration or danger. The bonus quest involves killing four spectral archmages, specifically the archmages that Arthas killed in the Undead Campaign's Reforged mission. Each drops a piece of a powerful item. The archmage fights aren't much to talk about, but once completed, the Ring of the Archmage is incredible, giving the holder an aura of mana regeneration. Once I have it, my priests have effectively limitless healing, and my heroes can sling spells much more often. After finishing off the Archmages, for some reason I unlock the bonus mission, because Twitch chat somehow convinced me it was an important part of this run, and then I clear to the final boss fight. I was excited for this showdown. The Jailer has great statistics and a formidable guard, until I realized that his guys could be pulled without angering him. I didn't even really try for this boss fight. The entire mission was so easy and it was disappointing. Another reforged flop. Next is a secret level that I unlocked during the Dungeons of Dalaran, the Crossing. It's a tower defense mission, literally. Enemies run down a predetermined lane, get shot by towers, and give money when killed. I use the money to build more towers. Weirdly enough, for some reason, this mission was completely remade and reforged. Similarly to the last mission, it's not exactly some great iconic scene from Warcraft they wanted people to relive. Why remake these two missions? I don't know the answer to this, but they absolutely cranked up the difficulty. This thing is hard, and it takes almost 40 minutes. After getting some advice from Twitch chat, I managed to get a setup that lets me hold on until the end. The final few waves are incredibly difficult. The portal's at low HP, and I can't take down the units on the second to last wave. They reach the portal, and it dies. And then, the victory screen comes up? What? This wasn't even the final wave. I was in the middle of fighting wave 30 when this happened. This mission is peak reforged. They changed things just for the sake of changing them, they threw proper difficulty balancing out the window, and they broke the mission in the process. Absolutely incredible. I don't think Reforged could have been any more of a screw up if they had tried. We don't get to go back to normal Warcraft just yet. The search for Illidan is a MOBA-style tug of war, but at this point I'm going to take anything that's not Reforged. Both sides have huge waves of allies who push down a lane, while I only control heroes. The objective is to secure Illidan in a box and have it slowly make its way to the allied base. On my side, the only people who can capture the transport are Kael, Vosh, and this panda bear guy that I got for doing the last mission. On the enemy side, only Maiev can capture the box. I kite Maiev down to this Fountain of Restoration and keep her constantly banished and body blocked by my heroes. This allows the transport to effortlessly cruise towards my base. This might have been the easiest deathless mission ever. If you're familiar with the Frozen Throne campaigns, Gates of the Abyss is one of the missions you are probably thinking, how in the world is this possible? And you would be in good company. I was dreading this from day one. The mission starts with Illidan channeling close to a demon portal. Over the 3 minutes, a huge number of demons spill out of the gate. I'm given an initial army that is moderately sized, intended to buy time until I can get stronger forces out. But due to the weak nature of Blood Elf and Naga troops, there is no way to fight all of the demons without a casualty. Fortunately, I went into this with a plan. Unfortunately, that doesn't make it easy. Despite knowing exactly what I wanted to do and how to do it, this 3 minute segment took me over an hour of attempts and 20 resets to do properly. I start by grabbing all the defenders around the base, giving me about 18 combat units to work with, and I remember to turn off the parasite on the Naga Sea Witch. It would be really unfortunate if a good run were to die because she created the timed life summon unit automatically. Good thing that never happened 4 times. After joining my forces, I grab the improved masonry upgrade, armor upgrade for my infantry, and sorceress adept training. After that, I queue a sorceress. I hand all of my best spellcasting items over to Lady Vosh. She uses forked lightning every time it's off cooldown. Kale's flamestrike does friendly fire damage, so I'm avoiding using it here. The enemies have a large number of spellcasters among them. It's completely random if they decide to blast my forces or if they go after the channeling Illidan instead. I need a decent number of them to hit Illidan or I will take too much damage too quickly. Once the Doomguards start spawning, my time is limited. They're bulky, do incredible damage, and have the War Stomp ability that stuns. It's really easy to lose forces to multiple stun-locking Doomguards. After holding for the first minute 30 seconds, my sorceress completes and I retreat. The sorceress has the invisibility skill, making a target invisible for 120 seconds as long as it doesn't attack or use spells. This ability is obviously incredibly powerful, and Blizzard didn't want this mission to be cheesable with it. All units I control are completely visible to all demons on the map. On top of that, invisibility is dispelled when Illidan steps onto the platform to start each ritual, and the channeling takes 3 minutes compared to the 2 minute duration of the ability. Somehow, despite all of that foresight, Blizzard forgot one simple thing. Illidan is considered my ally's unit, not mine, while channeling at the portal. If I use invisibility on him after he has already started channeling, let's just say when there's 2 minutes remaining, the invading demons won't be able to see him for the remainder of the event. I grab all of my units and abandon my base. The enemies will continue to attack even if Illidan himself is safe. The remaining time is by no means easy. My base is going to take some serious damage here, and if I let them, the demons will kill my keep, and at that point, I'm dead anyway. Vosh has to dive in and pull the enemies away from my command structure and into my remaining defensive towers, while her mana shield ability keeps her safe. After the 3 minutes are up, all of the demons die. I've suffered huge damage, but both masonry upgrades do a great job of keeping my base somewhat alive. Now that I've held off a demon onslaught that's as powerful as the end of many campaigns, it's time to start playing the mission. And the rest of the mission is no walk in the park. 3 more dimensional gates must be sealed in a process similar to the last one. Illidan's buddy Akama is also under attack in the south. An orc base has to be defeated to save them. I need Akama and his sneaky Draenei buddies for my next mission, so I decide to save them. And then there's a problem of the enemy orc bases. These are not normal orcs. They're fell orcs, who deal chaos damage and have increased stats. They cleave through my brittle units like butter. I can't engage them in a straight up fight. Even my heroes have a hard time with the larger attack waves. Instead, it's tower time, and I end up building an absolutely absurd number of guard towers in order to protect myself, while hiding my main forces in a safety spot. This is necessary both to hold off the Chaos Orcs as well as the freaking dragon attacks that they send. There's one upside to all of this. In Warcraft 3, heroes retain their items from mission to mission. That's pretty well known. What might not be as well known is that they also hold on to items from campaign to campaign. And now, I have Illidan on my side. The superpowered behemoth that I built via trading all of the best items from the last campaign is now here in full force to wreck house. And this time, he has support from Lady Vosh and Kale. I toss Illidan's mana stones to Vosh, who now holds a Sobi Mask, the Ring of the Archmage, and 2 mana stones. She gains enough mana to fire off a forked lightning approximately every 25 seconds. The first stop is the southern orc base. They won't stop harassing Illidan's buddy Akama until they're dealt with. Because Chaos Orcs are overpowered, I clear the base with heroes only. Only Illidan has the ability to tank incoming damage, because of his evasion ability and the Mask of Death. The fight through the base is a slow grind. One upside is that Kale's Flamestrike ability has a big radius, allowing it to burn multiple buildings at the same time. I leave the orange base with a single lumber mill remaining. If I finish the quest right now, the Draenei will start sending out raiding parties, and I can't have my ally throwing away units like that. All that remains are the three-dimensional gates. To prepare, I grab a Staff of Sanctuary from the shop, and I make sure to have Scrolls of Town Portal. The first ceiling is the easiest. I cast Invisibility on Illidan, while Vosh, Kale, and a Sorceress chill on the side. Once there's 2 minutes remaining, Vosh activates Mana Shield and runs past the demons, distracting them. While distracted, the Sorceress runs in, reapplies Invisibility, and is teleported away via the Staff of Sanctuary. Then my heroes can use the Scroll of Town Portal to retreat themselves. The next objective is significantly more tricky. I thought I could repeat the same strategy here. However, the Circle of Power is in a really awkward position. This combined with significantly stronger spawning enemies means that I could not get a Sorceress close enough to Illidan. Instead, I start on a huge infrastructure project. During all of this, the enemy has not let up. In addition to frequent raids from random Fel Orcs and a Fel Blade Master, multiple red dragons have been bludgeoning me. I genuinely try to avoid tower spam and Deathless runs as I feel it's not the most legitimate way to play, but I wasn't the one who put a literal tower defense mission in this campaign, so I'm gonna give myself a pass this time. My 15 towers in the north finish. All they have to do is buy 1 minute, and they easily manage to do that, but they are overwhelmed in the end. Before hitting up the final area, I send my heroes around the map to rescue various Draenei trapped in cages. Illidan couldn't bear to let his best friend's family stay imprisoned any longer. I then spend all of my money on a huge network of static defense to defend the last point. This one actually sends less demons overall, but they're some of the toughest enemies in the game. Vosh and Kale stay behind to help eliminate as many of the demon forces as I can. Fellhounds completely drain Illidan's mana and do a significant amount of damage to his life, but he survives, and at 2 minutes remaining, I cast Invisibility and retreat. Now the only task that remains is to finish off the Orange Orc's buildings and rescue Akama. Once that's done, I get to chill out for the remaining 1 minute and 30 seconds, and why is Illidan taking damage? I completely forgot that the Infernal has the Immolate ability. The demons finally have a way to damage Illidan through invisibility. I was fortunate here. The Shadow Orb that I traded to Illidan in the last campaign gives a dramatic increase to health regeneration. Without it, I'm positive that Illidan would have been killed by the fire. As the timer hits zero, it's obvious that Illidan has more than enough health. Illidan is fine. Don't worry. Overall, the Blood Elf campaign is very experimental with its level design. The Lord of Outland follows this trend. It's the only final mission in any Blizzard RTS campaign that doesn't follow the traditional mine resources to build an army formula. Instead, it's a no-build mission. The map is split into two parts. Kale's forces are on the left, joined by Akama's Draenei that I rescued in the previous mission, and Vosh's Naga are on the right. Normally, both sides are intended to clear through half of the map, activate a bridge where they can join forces, and then finish off the mission together. The map is infested with Fel Orcs and demons. This is another case of the enemies being too strong to fight with real armies. It's another hero-only mission. Instead, I have to set up my defenses at my pseudo-bases. Kale's side occasionally gets attacked and needs defending. Fortunately, Akama's Draenei that I rescued in the previous mission are all assassins. I create a stealth wall out of them and leave Kale's forces behind it. Vosh, on the other hand, never gets attacked, so I can leave her unprotected. My main force consists of the new hero unit Akama and Illidan himself. As long as Akama is not attacking or casting spells, he's invisible. The mission is designed around him destroying generators around the map to cripple the temple's defenses. He's also a powerful spellcaster. Chain Lightning is great against groups of enemies, and Shadow Strike does high single target damage. The Illidan-Akama combo is incredible. Normally, Illidan would be overwhelmed by the number of powerful enemies, but Akama's spells mean that large hordes can be cleared out quickly. And once the enemies have been thinned out, Illidan's Mask of Death quickly heals him faster than he takes damage. To make the combo more efficient, I head Illidan over to Vosh, grab her items, and give them to Akama. I wanted to take a minute to reflect on the incredible journey that this Mana Stone has gone on. In the Sentinels campaign, I looted it on mission 2 with my Ev. Its mana regeneration has been integral for most of the difficult strategies in the last two runs. When my Ev needed to blink around the Tomb of Gul'dan to get the Shadow Orb that saved Illidan in the previous mission, the Mana Stone was there. When Margoth the Defender needed as much mana as possible to keep Malfurion alive in the ruins of Dalaran, he used its power. When Malfurion had to spam Tranquility to mute the undead attack waves while Illidan won the mission, the Mana Stone fueled him. After being traded in that final mission and then brought to Draenor, it powered Vosh's support fire so that Illidan could take down the Chaos Orc bases. And finally, it rests in the hands of Akama, who's using it to claim the Black Temple for his friend. All in all, the stone has been used by 7 heroes across 2 campaigns and 2 planets. Frostmourne is a joke compared to this blue rock. Now that my team is fully equipped, it's time to win. The first objectives are the Master of Pain and the Mistress of Torment, powerful demon heroes who each have strong demonic bodyguards. Akama thrives here. Utilizing his stealth and ranged abilities, he can pull small groups of defenders, making the fights easy. The Mistress of Torment deals low damage and gives a 33% miss chance, and has a huge HP pool. This combo leads to what can only be described as the most exhilarating minute and a half of two units auto-attacking each other that I have ever seen. The Master of Pain's room is really poorly designed. Akama can sit in a corner, using Chain Lightning every time it's off cooldown, and by the time his enemies get near him, he's already activated his passive invisibility. The Master of Pain dies easily. All that's left is Magtheridan. He has a large room with a number of defenders in front of them, but they don't respawn and he doesn't assist them, so they're an easy clear. But how powerful is Magtheridan exactly? Unlike Archimonde or Cenarius, Magtheridan lacks the Divine Armor type, which is a shame because Illidan does chaos damage. Compared to Archimonde, Magtheridan has 1.5 times the HP, 1.5 times the armor, and about the same damage per attack, though he is melee. But the abilities is where Magtheridan goes crazy. Most heroes have 4 abilities. Archimonde has 5 abilities and spell immunity. Magtheridan, on the other hand, has Spell Resistance, True Sight, Finger of Death, Shockwave, Frenzy, War Stomp, Bash, Frost Nova, Reign of Chaos, Howl of Terror, Unholy Aura, and Cleave. If I want to engage the Pit Lord, I need precise planning and positioning. There's a healing fountain in the middle of the map that I choose as my battlefield. If I position Illidan correctly, he can gain the regeneration of the fountain while keeping Magtheridan out of it. It's a long path to bring Magtheridan to the fountain, but I make the best use of my time. I harass the boss with Illidan's mana burn ability. By the time we get to the real battle, Magtheridan's mana will be depleted and a majority of his abilities will be unusable. He still hits like a cleaving, stunning truck though. Illidan's health is dangerously low by the time I reach the fountain. Even with this setup, Magtheridan hits too hard. Illidan will die in the situation without aid. I need a unit more powerful than Illidan himself. Fortunately, this mission gives 2. From the right-hand side, I bring in 2 Naga Royal Guards that I start with, and chain-stun Magtheridan from 100% to 0% with Frostbolt. The fight wasn't even hard. Trivializing the third strongest enemy in Warcraft 3 and final boss of the campaign with Royal Guards after they plagued me through the last run is peak catharsis. It almost made my suffering worth it. Almost.